Hi everyone, thank you for participating in that session. My name is Virginie Cornu, I'm the VP of Data at Jellysmack, and I'm very happy to present to you today the company, who is Jellysmack, and how we use data and AI to empower creators. So first, what is Jellysmack? So Jellysmack detects and develops the world's most talented video creators through technology. Okay, so what does that mean? There are a lot of content creators out there, YouTubers, Instagrammers, influencers, and Jellysmack helps them to reach a bigger audience and maximize their revenue on several social media platforms while they focus on what they're passionate about, being creative. Now, that's not how Jellysmack started. At first, we were not helping creators, we were creators ourselves. Actually, the genesis of Jellysmack began with a realization. TV is being replaced by social media as the new source of entertainment. So we decided to create channels directly on social networks, but channels with thematics, so Gameology for gaming, Beauty with Beauty Studio, Oh My Goal for football, for example. And we decided to deploy those channels on several social network platforms, like YouTube, Facebook, Snapchat, everything we could think of. At the same time, we wanted to make sure that our content would be successful, making sure that it would be exactly what people wanted to watch. But how to do that with data science and AI? So we started browsing the web, analyzing videos, trends, the likes, the dislikes, all the metrics that we could find to detect the most promising topics to address, but also to publish the best version of each content at the best moment. The other challenge was that we had to make videos that would go on several platforms, even though they all require different configuration. I will give you some concrete examples later. You will see the challenges that we face with that. So we have been creating content like that for several years, and it is quite successful. We do more than 10 billion views every month, cross-platform, so YouTube, Facebook, Snapchat, Instagram, and TikTok. And we reach more than 500 million people every month. In the United States, we are the third largest company in terms of audience, just behind Disney Channel and Viacom CBS, with 125 million unique viewers. So we have been creating content like that for 5 years. And because we've been creators ourselves, we have a deep understanding on how it works to publish content on platforms. So after a few years, we decided to offer that expertise and our tools to other content creators like YouTubers and influencers. So most of the time, creators perform very well on one platform. YouTubers, for example, are very good on YouTube, but they don't really expand their content on other platforms because, well, actually, there are a lot of reasons, but to give you some examples, for example, their video need to be edited to go to another platform, and the creator doesn't necessarily have the time, the knowledge, or even the interest in doing video editing. Another reason is that they don't necessarily know the platform well enough to understand how to use their metrics, how to use the content, and especially how to address this new audience. The audience on platforms behaves differently depending on platforms. To give you two concrete examples to illustrate what I just mentioned, for the first point, the video editing, for example, on YouTube, the format of the video is 16:9. And on Facebook, it's 4:3. So if you want to release your content on Facebook, you first have to edit your video. The second example, when you go on Facebook, you know you will watch a video. You're there for that purpose. So you're kind of engaged. You know that you are going to stay the first 10 to 15 seconds. There is a minimal engagement. On Facebook, the video appears on your feed, and you didn't ask for it. You didn't necessarily search for it. So when it shows, the first 3 seconds have to be very catchy. So the same video that is working very well on YouTube may not be a hit at all on Facebook. At Jellysmack, this is the kind of thing that we are working on the data team. We provide automatic video editing, but also insights. For example, when the audience starts to drop out, what are the trendy topics, and what part of the video needs to be more dynamic, for example. So we started partnering with some creators that we detected had potential, and one of the first creators that we signed got an amazing success pretty soon. This creator was doing reaction video. So he was filming himself, reacting to different kinds of situations. So we thought, great, let's find other creators like that. Let's find more reaction creators and sign them. The problem was there is no precise categories on social media platform. So on some platforms, for example, videos are in, there are some categories, but they are very large in general. For example, football, basket, and tennis are in sports. And some other platforms, they don't have categories at all. So we needed really an in-house categorization. So we started exploring our options. We thought that maybe we could look at the titles to check if it actually contained reaction in it, but of course it was not that easy. And we found out that actually it was pretty rare to have this word, whether in the title or in the tag. On the other hand, a human being was perfectly capable of understanding that it was a reaction video. So we started a dataset manually, watching video, logging them, tagging them, and then feeding them to an algorithm so that it can start understanding what we were looking for. And one of the first patterns that we discovered was that actually the titles were often beginning with try not to plus something, and that something was often an emotion, like try not to cry watching this, try not to laugh watching this, try not to cringe, etc., etc. So with these data sets, we tried a text classification-based approach. We had a very easy access to the titles and the tags. So we did that on those parameters. We compared different methods. We tested on 5 different categories, animals, beauty, DIY, football, and basketball, because they were quite intuitive to understand. And I won't enter into the details, but you can see the result here. We concluded 2 things. We obtained much more accuracy on the tags than on the titles. And a simple CNN text classifier was the best compromise in terms of accuracy, speed, and memory. There's also some things that we had to take into consideration, and it's that categories don't have the same success depending on platforms. So for example, video for kids, they are very popular on YouTube, but not that much on Facebook. So the creator success can be very different depending on what category he addresses and on which platform. So then we decided not to stop here. We had a good model. It was performing very well. So we wanted to have a continuous learning process. So we embedded our model into our product so that it can be fed automatically by users' feedback. In one of our products, it looks a little bit like that. We have a list, we display a list of all the creators and the videos that we have discovered. And we have a lot of metrics around that, statistics, we have metadata, the name, the title, everything. And of course, we have the category. So we added this little line. This is a JellySmack category creating using AI. Is category correct? Now, everyone at JellySmack can click on a button to indicate whether or not this category is accurate. This action opens a pop-in where you can indicate actually at what category it should belong to instead, in your opinion. And then a notification is sent to our content experts within JellySmack. And if they validate the suggestion, then the video is sent back in the training set of the algorithm with the correct category. So this is a continuous learning process. It relies on human expertise, and that allows the scaling of the categorization. It wouldn't be possible, of course, otherwise, as we have more than 6.4 million creators as of now. With this work, we were quickly able to discover more than 4,000 creators doing reaction videos. We signed the top 35 most promising among them. And it allowed them to reach 12 billion views per month from zero, because they had no followers and actually no channel on Facebook or on other platforms. And it allowed us to earn $4 million in revenues overall. As of now, we have created 16 in-house categories This in-house categorization helps us also detect more precisely the promising creators. And as we are on a cross-platform perspective, we are also able to match the categories between the platforms. So this categorization project has been really fundamental to JSMAC's success. This is really a use case where where we scale the human expertise. JSMAC has integrated data pretty early in its product, but also in its mindset. When we saw that, we thought that everyone should be involved. So this is something everyone at JSMAC participates in. Every video we published is tagged with a dozen of metadata, and our machine learning algorithm can learn continuously thanks to that. So of course, now we have a huge data set composed of public data that come directly from the platforms. We have the private data that come from our own channels, and we have the proprietary data that is generated and enriched by everyone at JSMAC. So this project is really a mix of human and data science. It's the human expertise that made the data science part really valuable at the beginning and that allowed our algorithm to improve constantly. We'll just finish this presentation by saying that we work on many, many projects. We are in hypergrowth at JSMAC, and we recruit a lot in the data team and everywhere, actually. So don't hesitate to contact me or to go directly apply on our job boards. This is now the end of the presentation. We'll see maybe if there are some questions. Okay, I don't see any questions yet. Well, thank you, everyone. So I see a question. How do you keep data ambitions aligned when the company is growing so quickly? So yes, it's a challenge because we have to really grow the data team as fast as possible while maintaining every beautiful project that we have started. We are at the moment 31 people at the data team only, and we are going probably to double that during the year. But we have a solid foundation, like a solid team of data scientists and data analysts and business analysts that were here before. So they are kind of the people that we rely on at the moment to really keep on going. And we do really a recruitment around the same culture. We try to really integrate everyone in both with their hard skills, but also soft skills, especially as we are remote, so that we can keep really a cohesion in the company. We also work in squads. We are actually trying the Spotify model with tribes and squads, but it was already in squads before. So data scientists are involved with development teams. They are really in the squad team. And that's also why I think we can really deploy all our data products quite easily.